The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Good morning and welcome to chapel. It's a pleasure to be with you today. The last 2 weeks at our Ann Arbor campus, they've been going through a series covering the Sermon on the Mount from Matthew chapters 5, 6, and 7. Today we're going to parallel them a little bit and turn our attention toward that. Many of you are familiar with Jesus' words and that great message. For our scripture reading this morning, I'd like to share with you, if I could, sort of the bookends, the lead-in to the Sermon on the Mount, and then the final words, the conclusion to it. And as I do, I'd like to encourage or invite you to put yourself in the crowd that day. Put yourself there on that mountainside. What was it like to see and to hear Jesus preaching that powerful message? God's word to us from Matthew chapter 24, from chapter 4, beginning at verse 25. And great crowds followed him from Galilee and the Decapolis, and from Jerusalem and Judea, and from beyond the Jordan. Seeing the crowds, he went up on the mountain. And when he sat down, his disciples came to him, and he opened his mouth, and he taught them. Then follows the Sermon on the Mount, chapter 7. And when Jesus finished these sayings, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he was teaching them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Wasn't that amazing? Have you ever heard anything like it? You know, I've heard the rabbis teach and preach for years, really all my life, and I have never heard anything so authentic, so real, that touches my life. I hope you felt the same way. You know, I had heard about Jesus long before this. He's been out. I've heard the stories about him healing and doing miracles and some of the words that he's spoken, but to see him in person and to hear these words is just incredible. I don't know about you, but for me, you know, I can sort of sum it up in three words that really touched me. Life, love, and lean. As I listened to him, was about what does it mean to live as God's people? What does it look like in my life? You know, our teachers, our scribes, our Pharisees, the rabbis, you know, they really hammer us with the law, don't they? In fact, the laws of Moses, that's not enough for them. They've got to add on their own and expect us to keep them. And they puff up their chests that, yeah, you want to be righteous like I am. Who can do it? Who can do it? But as I listened to Jesus, he made it clear he didn't come to abolish the law, but he's the one who came to fulfill the law, to keep it all, because he knows we can't. But beyond that, he made it clear, didn't he? You all heard it. It's not just about what you do. In a sense, he set us to a higher standard. What's in your heart? What's in your mind? Think about some of the examples he gave about how we look at others, how we think of others, how we feel about others. Really? Can any of us look in our hearts and claim that we're even close to righteous? But he is. He's kept it all, even though we can't. But yet he invites us to claim his righteousness and to live in a different way, to live in a different way that sends us out then as salt and light. You know the impact of salt. Just a little bit can make a difference, can really change everything around it. Imagine if all of us who heard him today, as we're scattered around, the impact that we could make. Or that little light in a dark room, instead of covering it up and hiding it, that light changes everything around it. It casts out the darkness. Darkness cannot overcome that light. Imagine if our lives were those lights that could shine. This love and this grace that Jesus talked about, that he's willing to give to us. It really says a lot about his love. And that was the second thing that really touched me. The love that came out, the love that he calls us to have, but the love that he showed for all of us. You know, when he started out his message, he talked about how so many who are looked down upon, who are thought of as cursed and just the downtrodden and broken and almost the worthless of our society, how he called them blessed. Blessed. There's not a one of them he doesn't love. There's not a one of us he doesn't love. But then he also challenges us to love as he loves, to love even our enemies. My goodness, who in the world can do that? There are people I can't stand. Sometimes even in our own household. And he says, love your enemies? But I guess if you think about it, when you look back on the way we ought to live, even we're enemies of God by virtue of our sin. But yet that didn't stop him from loving us enough to send us Jesus. So to him who first loved us, his challenge to us then to love even our enemies, it's one I can take up, following his lead, following his help. His call to be careful about judging others. We're pretty good at that, aren't we? Anybody else in that camp too? We judge ourselves by our intentions. We judge others by the actions as we interpret them. What if we judged others with eyes of love and loved all those who he called blessed? What if we, out of love, could help even the most needy in our society, in our communities? I guess that would be like a little salt being sprinkled around. But this life that he calls us to, and even the love that he pours out on us, it's so far beyond me. But even there, his words brought great comfort, because we're able to lean on him. He even gave us a prayer. Our Lord Jesus gave us this prayer that really brings together everything we need. He invited us to actually call God our Father. What a wonderful invitation. To call out to our Father in heaven, to help us then to live calling his name holy, knowing that He'll respond and provide for whatever our needs are. He takes care of, you know, the birds of the air and the plants, and certainly He'll take care of us. I loved it when He said that if we as earthly fathers are so concerned about providing for our children, how much more will our Father in heaven give us our daily bread? And even helps us deal with our sin, reminding us to forgive others even as He forgives us so greatly, so immensely, so much more than anything we'd ever need to forgive of others. It's Him who we lean on because we need His strength. We need what only He can bring. We need Him as our Savior. You know, as I reflect on His words today, there's something different about Him, isn't there? He's not just another teacher, not just another rabbi, not just somebody worthy of following. People have said that maybe He is the Messiah, the promised one of God. His words today certainly speak of that, of His great love and forgiveness, His calling us to a new and a better way, a way of hope and promise. That's our Lord. That's our Jesus. Today was the first day I had a chance to see Him. I'm looking forward to following Him, along with all of you.